Hello, welcome to Will Radio, part two, upping the difficulty. So this is, this is episode 12 in my series. There apparently is no episode five. For whatever reason, I started doing five and I didn't finish it, and then I just moved on to six. So there's no episode five, so we'll call it 12. I guess that's really 11. Let's talk a little bit in this episode about the strategy I'm trying with these videos, trying to make 1,024 videos this year, 1 kiloTube of videos. Let's talk a little bit about why I'm doing it and the theory behind it, which I think is tied, at least to some extent, with the previous video, or the previous Will Radio about creative and idiosyncratic thinking. So basically, I'm applying some of the techniques that I know for idiosyncratic and creative thinking to myself in the process of making these videos. So, self-application here. And, really the reason I decided to try to make so many videos this year is I suffer from significant anxiety when it comes to creating things, and that's videos or books. And I'd say the type of thing that I'm anxious about creating is the type of thing where you can polish it, sort of an unbounded amount before you release it into the world. Okay. And I've had a lot of experience teaching, lecturing, giving talks, mentoring people. I did Google Hangout series and did uncourses and those sorts of things. And I'm fairly well known for that. And for those, there's a difference. It's not like I didn't have any anxiety about those things. Okay. I always had some anxiety about it, but they all had an endpoint or a deadline or an audience that was waiting for me. So I just had to get out of my own skin and just do it. And I remember when I first started giving talks, academic talks, I had this sort of unusual and unpleasant experience where I was so anxious that in the middle of each talk, even if the talk was going well, there was always a point where I would have a little pause and I would suddenly think to myself, what in the world am I doing? I'm in front of all these people, they're looking at me. And here's some slides. I don't remember what I'm going to say. And how are the words coming out of my mouth anyway? I've got this, air is coming out of my lungs and somehow my brain is just filling in. I'm basically just improvising because I haven't planned out every word. Somehow it's coming out and I'm afraid it's going to stop working. That reminds me of Alex Honnold, who was free climbing, I think this was Half Dome or El Capitan in Yosemite. And he got to this ledge and was resting on this ledge, which is 8 inches wide or something. He's 1,000 feet above the deck without a rope. And he'd been climbing, confidently until then. And he said, once he got to the ledge, and he's like, what am I doing? And he freaked out and he had to sort of calm himself down in order to keep climbing. And that would happen to me when I gave a talk. Over time, that started happening less. It still happened every talk, but I had strategies. I would, have a glass of water and I would stop and, pause for a minute and collect my thoughts, take a glass of water, wait for a couple beats and then continue. All right. So I get it under control, but that happened to me reliably. Over many, many talks, eventually it went away. And there's, that's interesting. That hasn't happened to me. So it wasn't like I didn't have anxiety. I did have anxiety, but, I just had to do it. The show must go on, that kind of thing. So, and the other thing is I learned a strategy, which is the feeling of anxiety before I gave a talk or before I gave a lecture, I could interpret that as fear or anxiety, but I could also interpret it as excitement, because anxiety and excitement feel awfully the same. They feel very, very similar. So I would say, oh, I'm really excited. I'm very, very excited. You know, actually, I can remember one example. Dan Friedman and I gave a talk at the second Closure Conj, where we showed off Mini Kanren and relational interpreters and all that. And famously, that's the one where Stu Holloway said, hey, you should be able to do quines. That was an important talk for us. But I remember going to the bathroom before that talk and just sitting in the bathroom stall, like basically freaking out, thinking, oh my gosh, we agreed to do this. You know, we offered to do this impromptu talk. We haven't prepared it, you know, and I just convinced myself, okay, I'm actually feeling excitement. I'm really excited. And we went on stage and had a great time. But, you know, I sort of had to convince myself that I'm actually feeling excitement, not fear or anxiety. So, you know, it's not like I haven't had anxiety dealing with those things. But the great thing about a talk is, hey, the talk is in 40 minutes. The talk is in 2 days. The talk's in 2 weeks. There will be a start time for the talk. And then the talk goes for 12 minutes or 40 minutes or an hour, and then it's over. And if it went well, great. And if it didn't go well, great. You know, move on with your life. And there's another talk that you can give. If you're teaching a class, if that lecture didn't go so well, well, you're giving the next lecture in 2 days, maybe. So that one will be better. So I can deal with that. But when there's no end date and there's no start date in the same way, I have had real trouble dealing with that. And so instead, everything's got to be perfect. You know, if I'm making a video, I've got to do 76 takes and everything's got to be perfect. And oh no, take 74, I could hear there was a car in the background for a quarter of a second. Okay, throw it away. Or I've got to learn, you know, audio editing at a professional level. And try to do heroic audio processing to remove that sound. You know, that's the mindset I get into. So the same thing with making videos, writing books, writing technical notes. I was going to write a series of technical notes, sort of like the AI memos from MIT, talking about Mini Kanren relational programming. I was going to do a whole series of these. And I would start all of these things. I've started books multiple times. I've started videos multiple times. I've started technical notes, series like that. Every single time I get into it, I'm super excited. I've written books where, you know, I spent months waking up early every single morning, waking up at 4 a.m., 5 a.m., and working for hours before work, working on the book. I've done this multiple times. And every single time I just throw it all away because I look at it and I say, this is hopeless. It's worthless. Forget it. And I get rid of it. So, you know, there's a manifesto I read for the Cult of Done by some makers. And that also reminds me of this idea about closers. Carolyn Bertozzi, a famous biochemist, I read an interview with her, and the question was, what do you look for in, say, a postdoc or a grad student? And she said, I look for closers. I look for people who can close projects. They come in and they finish up the project and they write it up and they move on to the next thing. And it reminds me, I guess, of Glenn Larry, Glenn Ross. You know, these are the leads for closers. And so Dan Friedman is a closer. If you give Dan a book project, he's going to end up with a book. There will be a book you hold in your hand from MIT Press, you know, a certain number of months later. That's just the way it is. Okay, so Dan's very, very good at that. I am not good at that. So that's what I really want to work on. And so part of my idea of trying to do an absurd number of videos is based on this idea with this training for space shuttle astronauts and the flight control staff at, you know, Houston or Cape Canaveral for the space shuttle. So it turned out when the space shuttle was a thing, there were these simulators where the astronauts would be in the simulator simulating flying the space shuttle. There would be the mission control people talking with the astronauts. And then there would be a third group who had the ability to inject faults into the system. So they could pretend that there was an oxygen leak on the space shuttle. And they could pretend that, you know, one of the computers failed. And they could pretend that, you know, whatever happened, right? So they could pretend that there were the systems failing. And what they would do during these simulation practices on the ground is that they wouldn't inject one fault an hour. They would inject, you know, 15 faults an hour, something like that. And as soon as you're trying to fix one thing, as soon as one thing's fixed, there's another problem. Or maybe there are two problems at once. Maybe there are three problems at once. So the idea was there's never a moment where something isn't going wrong. And the mission control specialists and also the astronauts just got used to dealing with this. Okay, what is the emergency procedure for this? Okay, let's run through the checklist. Okay, got it. Identify the engine that has a problem. Let's go through the procedure. Okay, what do we do? And they just got into the practice where they could handle 15 emergencies per hour or whatever the number was. It's a large number. So basically, the idea was to load up those astronauts and controllers with absolutely as many emergencies in unusual circumstances that they could handle, you know, and over time they could handle more per hour. And the astronaut said that if you could survive the simulator on the ground, you know, spaceflight was actually a breeze. In spaceflight, maybe one thing goes wrong, not 15 things an hour or 30 things an hour. So that was part of the idea, that there's this intentional overload. And, you know, what they were trying to simulate was the anxiety of something happening on orbit when you're in the space shuttle and something goes wrong. Well, you just can't fix it, you know, unless you do a spacewalk or something like that, because there are parts of the spacecraft you can't reach. So it's very anxiety producing. So how do you simulate that on the ground? Well, you simulate it by, you know, sort of overloading in terms of just the volume. And so, okay, how do I change my attitude? One way is by sort of this overload. So if I always have one more video I have to make, then, all right, I get a video, I process the audio, I upload it to YouTube, give a description, maybe put something about the Discord server. Okay, what's next? Now it's time to make the next video or think about the next video, right? That's the whole process. In fact, even when I'm getting ready, setting up for one video, I'm thinking already about the next video. And if one video is not great, well, all right, that's fine. But it's time to think about the next video. Okay, so that's the idea. And so I call this the factory mentality or the McDonald's mentality. I was like, okay, you served a hamburger. That's great. You made a hamburger. Guess what time it is? It's time to make a hamburger. Okay, you made another hamburger. Guess what? It's time to make three cheeseburgers. Okay, so that sort of mentality, or the Ed Wood quote from the Ed Wood movie. Okay, my movie is terrible. Well, okay, my next one will be better. That sort of attitude where, okay, that was in the past, but it's time to go on and make the next one. And so that's why I came up with this KiloTube challenge for myself to make 1,024 videos in 1 year. And I think it's helping. It's helping a lot. First of all, it helped me work out a lot of issues like how do you figure out how to set up a microphone? How do you do audio processing? How do you do leveling for YouTube? And, you know, how do you record something in high def? You know, all those sorts of technical things I'm gradually working out. And also sort of what's my style? You know, can I get away with a video with Emacs and just text on it? Well, turns out I can, or at least I'm going to. Well, we'll see what happens, right? So I'm not really worried about how many views I have or the comments or anything like that. I'm just going to make a bunch of videos, move on to the next one, okay? And if you don't like a video, maybe you'll like the one 10 videos from now. Or come back when I'm on video 900, okay? Maybe I'll figure something out. So it just gets me out of this critic model where I'm criticizing everything to death. Okay. Now, one observation that I've already had, and I suspected this might be the case. You know, people are saying, wow, I can't believe you're trying to make so many videos. No one does that. That's a ridiculous number of videos. My initial thought was, well, if I look at how many StarCraft games I had to play before I started feeling even comfortable playing, it was about 3,000 competitive ladder games. How many talks did I have to give or public speaking, you know, engagements or talks at summer camp or, you know, talks in front of students or parents when I was a teacher? How many of those did I have to give before I started feeling comfortable? And I calculated once, it's probably around 3,000. So I actually think the real number for me is probably around 3,000 videos I will have started to zone in on a style that I feel comfortable with. Maybe I can get there a little faster than 3,000. At right now, at this pace, 3,000 is about 3 years. And that sounds about right. If I'm making videos, you know, literally 3 videos a day, every day for 3 years, by the time 3 years comes around, I probably feel pretty comfortable with it. But, you know, part of this is it turns out that 1,000 videos a year, you know, doesn't seem that hard because my only rule is I have to make 3 videos a day. It does, you know, on average. It doesn't mean that the videos have to be good. It doesn't mean they have to be interesting. It doesn't mean they have to be long. It doesn't mean they have to be on a particularly interesting topic. I can make any videos I want. I can make a whole bunch of 1 minute videos. I can make YouTube shorts that are 15 seconds long. And as long as I make them and upload them to YouTube, it counts. So I can make the challenge as hard or as easy as I want. So in some sense, I've already figured out, okay, this is too easy. It's not that hard. So I thought about making it a 3,000 video challenge, 3,000 videos this year. And I could do that. I think I actually could do that. That might be a bit of a burden. You know, 1,000, I think I can handle, or 1,024, I think I can handle no problem. But as I was thinking about it, you know, the beginning of this year, I was writing down, what are the things I want to do this year? What are the things I really want to spend more time on? Well, I want to learn Japanese. I want to speak more Japanese. Okay. I want to get into StarCraft, Brood War. You know, I want to learn a few things. I want to learn some things about physics and learn more about general relativity. I want to learn, you know, supercompilation and reversible computing, blah, blah, blah. Okay. So I want to learn these things. But one of the things I want to get over is not just my anxiety for creating videos, but my anxiety for creating other things. And that includes books, especially books. Okay. Because I've tried making books by myself multiple times. I've failed every single time, like failed miserably, you know, not even miserably, just like, you know, failed with a whimper where I'd work on this thing every day for months and then just throw it away. And it is exactly the same phenomena as me doing 76 takes of a video and then throwing it all away. Exactly the same phenomena. So I was thinking last night, well, what do I do about the books? You know, it's great that I'm going to learn how to make videos, at least. And I didn't say good videos. I just say I will learn how to make videos. And I'll get over my anxiety with the videos. I think I'm already getting there. What do I do about the books? So if I'm busy making videos and I never make any books, well, I've made some progress because I wasn't making books before. But that's not really what I want to do. I also want to learn how to make books. And I have the same challenge. So what I'm going to do is the same thing I did to try to get over the anxiety for creating videos, which was instead of making 3 videos a month or 5 videos a month, make 3 videos a day. So I'm going to do something like that when it comes to writing and books. And I thought about this quite a bit last night. What should I do? I read some writing advice by Robert Heinlein from a talk he gave at the Naval Academy graduation. And he laid out 5 points. But he also talked about the importance of closing, of finishing the book, and the importance of submitting the book to a publisher and trying your best to get it published. And I thought, okay, that's interesting. So that really is an example of closing. So closing isn't just making something, and here's a PDF, but closing is I'm at the point where I'm submitting it to a publisher. I'm having conversations with publishers. I'm getting rejections. Okay. And if I get rejected, I send it to another publisher and I just keep doing that. And either eventually it gets published or, you know, I send it to every publisher who might even consider publishing it. So that's what I'm going to do. And my goal is 11 finished books this year, each with a Creative Commons license submitted to a publisher in 2024. Doesn't have to be accepted, doesn't have to be published, but I want to have 11 finished books that I've submitted to publishers. I picked 11 because we're at the end of January, and so basically one per month. I didn't say these are going to be good books. I didn't say they'd be interesting books. I didn't say they'd be well-written books. I didn't say they'd be long books. They will be books, and I will submit them. And at the end of each month, I will say that book is done, and I'll submit it. And if I get a rejection letter, or if I get a letter saying, this is interesting, if you make these revisions, we'll consider, well, then I will make revisions if it makes sense, or I won't. But that's what I'm going to do. So 11 finished books submitted to publishers. The books will be under Creative Commons licenses. So some publishers might say, well, that's a deal breaker. Some publishers like MIT Press have done arrangements where they've been willing to publish books that were under Creative Commons. So we'll see. But in any case, that's not really the point. The point is I'm going through that process. I'm finishing books. The books may not be great, but I'll try to make them as good as I can within the time constraints of a month. And as part of this, I am going to, you know, make videos of me writing the books. Okay, so actually that's an important part, which I forgot. Writing books will be recorded and posted on YouTube. All right, so there we go. So I was thinking, how in the world am I going to have time to do this? How am I going to have time to write 11 books? Oh, well, how about I just show myself writing the books? And for anyone who hasn't written a book before, you know, I have been part of two books that have been published by MIT Press. You know, Dan Friedman's the expert there at getting those books published. But people have asked me, okay, what's your next book going to be on? So I'll just go ahead and show the process, and it'll be Creative Commons anyway. So that's all fine. And, you know, I'll show and maybe I can improve this, but if I do it in LaTeX, for example, I can show you how I set things up and the problem solving and all that. And I'll have to figure out what are the topics for these books. I'll figure some of that out as I go. But I've decided already the first book is going to be Strategies for Idiosyncratic and Creative Thinking, partly because I just made a video on it and I have it on my, you know, in my head, and people are starting to comment on Will Radio number one. So I'm getting some good comments and pointers to other things I can look at, partly because some feedback I got on that Will Radio number one video was, well, there's some interesting strategies there, but you're just going on too much. You know, really, you need to pare that down. Can you make that a 10-minute video? Well, I don't know if I can make it a 10-minute video, but certainly I should be able to make it much shorter. Maybe I'll pare it down, edit down the ideas and the stories, make another video that's much more compact that includes a few more strategies. But as part of that process, I also want to write them up. And this also gets me out of my, you know, self-criticism, because what I think is, well, who am I to tell anyone, you know, what are strategies for creativity? I'm not a creative person. I'm not an idiosyncratic person. So why should I tell anyone anything? Why should they believe me? So that sort of thinking. And then also the, okay, this isn't perfect. It's not perfectly polished. You're trying to cut off that as well. Or this needs to be a 400-page book. It's going to take me 3 years to finish. All that side, that type of thinking, I'm going to get rid of it. And I'm just going to write a very, very short book. What is the minimum book I can write that's useful? And I just went on Amazon, by the way, and once again did a sweep over all the books I could find on creative and idiosyncratic thinking. And I ordered one or two more. But I've read a lot of these books, and they're almost all, to me, disappointing. It's usually, well, how to do, you know, creativity for advertising, and here's how to do your, you know, sales pitch for a new ad campaign, and here's how to navigate the corporate boardroom, and, you know, that kind of thing just doesn't interest me at all. So I want to make my take on strategies in idiosyncratic and creative thinking, write a short book. People ask me for advice about this anyway, because I actually do have a reputation among people who know me for thinking differently. So, you know, might as well write it up as well as I can within a month. So that's going to be the book for February. The book is going to be done, in the can, sent out to publishers. I'll send out to MIT Press first under Creative Commons license, see if they like it or not, see if they even return my, you know, email. But that's the first one. And then I've got 10 more books to write this year, and I'll have to think about it. I've got some ideas, but if you have any suggestions for topics, I will think about it. And I want to tie those books, at least to some extent, with other topics I'm interested in talking about. So, like I said, I'm going to record all the writing, the process of making a book, the editing, all of that I'm going to record. I'm not going to record conversations with individual people who are publishers or that kind of thing, just for privacy reasons. But the actual creation of the book and the editing of the book, I will record everything. That's my challenge. Okay. And that's a great way to get more videos. Got to get to 1,024. So that works both ways. So that is my upping the difficulty, because 1,024 videos this year is turning out to be too easy. All right. Thank you, and I'll see you in another video soon.